know, the concern we have for the dunya, that we won't care about our prized possessions. We don't really care about these things. وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ عُطِّلَتْ. And when the 10-month pregnant she-camels are neglected. وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. Look at this. Not only us. The fear will pervade in every kingdom. In the animal kingdom as well. So وُحُوشُ, you know, the wild beasts who fear no one. The wild beasts. وُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. They shall huddle together and gather together. Subhanallah. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the lion, yeah, and the deer huddled together? Yeah? The predator and the prey together. The hunter and the hunted. Because they forget their old rivalries, their old relationship. Yeah, the cat and the mouse, this previous relationship that they used to have, suddenly forgotten because they're all focused on one fact. They're all focused and they're worried and concerned what is going to happen now, because the world is being destroyed. Because everything else which was big has become suddenly small and nothing. You see, brothers, nothing is stable. This ayah, these ayahs in the beginning is teaching us that don't, the things you see around us, don't give your life for this. Don't anchor and live for these things. None of these things are stable. Even your relationship, the way you see, even your children, isn't it? In another verse, for human beings as well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, yeah, that on the day when, you know, when sahibihi wa bani, his you know, his sons, his children, family, they will come. لِكُلِّ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِي. Everybody will be concerned about themselves because they will be so scared on that day. Subhanallah, brother. وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ. And when the seas, you know, shall overflow into another, or shall be set ablaze. There's two meanings of sujirat. When the seas, you see, brothers, things we take for granted shall be set ablaze. The seas, you know, very strange. We can't imagine, you know, what does it mean? Because we can't equate water with fire. But when the seas shall be set ablaze, what does this mean? You know, if it seems contradictory, but fa'alu lima yurid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can, He does whatever He wills. And so those things, like I said, again, what we take for granted can change. You know, some of the mufassirin, they try to give us some view or vision of what that meant. It could be volcanoes. And when, you know, the lava comes out, isn't it, and meets the seas, and the seas are set ablaze. You know, I read one contemporary mufassir, he mentioned something very interesting actually. His discussion is on a molecular level. Yeah? He said, Subhanallah, if you just think about the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, look, water, what is water made up of? H2O. Yeah, it's made up of oxygen and hydrogen. What does oxygen do when it comes in contact with fire? It kindles the fire, isn't it? It fans the fire. What does hydrogen do? Itself, it gets kindled. It's a fire, isn't it? You heard the hydrogen bomb? Itself is a fire, subhanallah. But with these two things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created water. Can you, if you think about it, subhanallah. And with these two things, the one that ignites and one that gets ignited, then is used to, isn't it, to put out a fire. Subhanallah. If you really think about it. So وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ, you know, سُجِّرَتْ. And when the seas are set ablaze, it doesn't seem actually all that strange when you appreciate the properties of water and you think about it, subhanallah. Of course the seas can be, what is it made of? What is it composed of? So when the seas shall be blazing in fire, وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ. And when the nufus and when their souls shall be paired. See, when we die, our soul and our ruh depart this body. Isn't it? It departs this body. And on Yom Al Qiyamah, what will happen is that these two souls will be paired up again. And the soul will come, and the body will be like when he had died. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, will resurrect the people on the day. So imagine, my brothers, those who are alive, they're seeing this catastrophe that is the Day of Judgment. And those who are resurrected, you see, and the nufus, it is not a normal, it is such an abnormal, extraordinary, fearful situation. And then look, this momentous cataclysmic offense, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. On that level, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He puts on that category the child and the oppression in the dunya. My brothers, think about this. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ. And when the girl, the baby girl, you know, who had been killed alive, buried alive, is asked, بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. What was your crime? What sin did you commit for you to be buried alive? Before I go into this, the number of discussion we can have, but just think about the order, my brothers. Do you see? The sun, the moon, the seas, everything. But on that level of catastrophe is the zulum that is committed to the child. Do you see? You have to appreciate that. You have to understand who is being addressed here. And the struggle, the context of the struggle in which this ayah came. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is sitting in Mecca with his companions. He has brought a new deen. And Quraysh and Mecca is steeped in shirk and kufr, isn't it? In polytheism. And in their social practices, evil practices. The way they would look after their women, the treatment of women. They will look down on women, my brothers, in terms of their social relationships. Ibn Abbas radiallahu an, he said that, you know, those days women, you know, when she's, you know, bearing child, just before she would, you know, deliver the child, what she would do is she would go off somewhere and she would dig a hole. And if she found that a baby girl was born, she would chuck this baby in the hole and bury that baby. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. And if it's a son, she would keep that baby. This is how, you know, they used to look down upon women. It was a shame. It was a aib. And that's at birth. Even, you know, it's mentioned in narrations that they, even afterwards, they would do that. You know, when they're older, you know, this Banu Tamim, this man from Banu Tamim came to Rasulullah crying, said, Ya Rasulullah, my sins will never be forgiven. Never shall my sins be forgiven. Rasulullah said, what did you do? Said, Ya Rasulullah, you can't imagine the heinous thing that I did. In Jahiliyyah, I took my baby child, my daughter, and I took her because I was filled with this disgust and shame. Because in another verse, Allah describes how their, you know, their faces go black. Yeah, because they're so angry and they're so embarrassed. Full of shame that a daughter has been born. So he said, because of this jahiliyyah in me, well, you know, I took my daughter to somewhere. And I was digging the grave and the dust was falling on me. She was cleaning the dust. Ya Rasulullah. And he was weeping. You know, some of the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, you know. He said, no, let him finish. I want to hear. Yeah, so he said, you know, he took the dust off. You know, the child is taking the dust off. He said, I dug that grave. You know, I put my child in. And I took a stone. And I